Warning. The show you're about to see contains material unsuitable for children and questionable among most adults. Viewer discretion is advised.
The Special Without Brett Davis presents the next superstar of science!
Brought to you by a generous grant from the Achexa Foundation.
Appearing tonight, Jesse Cam! Musical guest, Diet Cig! All right, everybody, who's ready for the next superstar of science? I give it up for yourselves, huh? I love this crowd, but first, before we get things started, who's ready for a joke of the week? Am I right? You guys know what I'm talking about, huh? I love this crowd. Oh, man, all this talk about science and astronomy. You know, I can't even handle it. I get embarrassed when I talk about my astrological sign. But that could be because I'm 29 years old and still a Virgo, people. There you go. Hey. All right. Good crowd. Good crowd. All right. Guys, give it up for yourself. Oh, man, that's amazing. And, you know, everybody's doing this speed dating these days. I love this crowd. All right. Thank you. Oh, boy.
Welcome, audience. On September 20th, 1980, American astronomer, cosmologist, astrophysicist, astrobiologist, and author Carl Sagan welcomed viewers to Cosmos, a personal journey. It dealt with the origin of life, and it explained our place in the universe. It inspired, informed, enlightened viewers all across the globe. Again in 2014, Neil deGrasse Tyson followed it up with Cosmos, a space-time odyssey. Last year, it was announced that writer and producer and close personal friend, Seth MacFarlane, has greenlit a third Cosmos series. We began a worldwide search to find the next host of this series to follow in the footsteps of some of the most unique minds the world has ever seen. We've narrowed it down to the finalists, and tonight you, the viewer at home, will decide who will be the host of Cosmos 3, A Celestial Safari. So without further ado, let's meet our finalists. Our first guest is an astrophysicist and former science ambassador for the White House in 2009 and in 2012. He believes passionately in bringing knowledge of our complex and beautiful universe to everyday people and everyday language. Here is Gene Tatara.
Hi, my name is Gene Tuatara. I'm a doctor of astrophysics and the author of several popular books on science, most notably among them, Saturn's Violin, The Songs That Gravity Sings Us. I'm also the author of When Will Science Be Done? Sawdust from God's Workshop, Gould's Gold, an appreciation of Stephen Jay Gould in a collection of essays, and Saturn's Guitar, a companion workbook to Saturn's Violin for high school students. I strongly believe that the lessons of science are something that every human being will benefit from learning, often framed in language too obscure or abstruse for the everyday person to understand. When these messages are brought to them, they can understand something about the beauty of the universe, their place in it, how small they are, and yet how very big.
Dr. Tatara, I can only imagine being a young person with an interest in the cosmos, what the Cosmos series must have meant to you.
Absolutely. You know, I used to watch it sprawled out on the floor at my folks' house, and my dad would join me. And my father was a working man. You know, he was not someone who had any interest in the larger world. But we watched this together, and as he began to understand just how many stars there were, how many atoms make up a hand? You know, there are more atoms in a droplet of water than there are droplets of water in the Atlantic Ocean.
Yes.
And he, that's good that you know it. I wonder how many people out there knew it. When my father began to understand these things, he began to understand the kind of stuff that I was interested in. We got closer, and I eventually went to school and began to make discoveries of my own. These I could share with my father, and we understood them through the fabric of this popularization of science that Dr. Sagan brought us. And I would love to have the opportunity to continue that legacy of Dr. Sagan and bring joy and understanding to people all across the globe.
And now you're on the precipice of that opportunity. You're so close, but yet you have competition tonight.
Well, I do. That's true.
To your left is Daniel Simonsen. There are 7.4 billion people on this planet. Teleprompter up. Why are you the best person out of those? Teleprompter up. Why are you the best person out of those 7.4 billion people for this job? And how will you reach out to people to make these complex scientific ideas palpable to them?
Well, first, a little bit about myself. I'm from Norway, where I had my own TV show about science called Folkeopplysningen on NRK 2, which is the second largest station in Norway after NRK 1. So also I've been a lecturer at the University at Oslo. I'm very highly respected, as they say, and I have a PhD in science.
Now, imagine, everybody, how many planets there are in the universe. We don't even know. Well, you know it's true? We all find it fascinating. Okay, now, how exciting won't it be for the next few years to learn our position in the universe? Now, what kind of role do you think that you will play in informing generations?
Well, I would like to be an inspiration for the future generations. And also, I would like to make science more fun.
Yes.
I heard people say it's boring with science, which is not the case at all. Mm. It's actually everywhere around us. So sometimes you see a guy, he wears a t-shirt. He's walking down the street. And on the t-shirt, there's a wolf. But above the wolf, there is the moon. You see what happened there? He snuck in again. It actually reminds me, Mr. Joker, he had a joke. We have a joke in Norway that's very popular. How far is it to the moon?
Dr. Tatar, maybe you could...
several hundred thousand miles, yes.
Well, in Norway we say you should ask Stanley Kubrick. He told me it's in Hollywood.
Perhaps more entertaining than illuminating.
What we're going to do is we're going to introduce to you the third finalist. Now, the former contestant, he had a family death, and he had to drop out of the competition. But we've got a very special person filling his place. He was the unprecedented winner of the first Wanna Be a VJ contest on MTV, beating over 5,000 other contestants. That's five times as many of the people that you beat out. He was the host of Lunch with Jesse and MTV Rocks Off. He was also the lead singer of Jesse and the 8th Street Kids, and he appeared in the film Crossroads starring Britney Spears. He has no background in science. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jesse Camp.
Guys, hey.
Hey, how are you doing?
Nice to meet you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for being here.
Hey, you guys, listen, I was just down at the Duane Reade over on 59th, and there was a very, very enthusiastic intern who said, hey, we need you for something, so this looks the next superstar of science. I'm ready for it. Man, if you can survive the Joy Behar show, this should be a snap.
Jesse, thank you so much for being here.
Honored.
Now,
who thought like a chance encounter getting Q-tips would lead to appearing on the next superstar of science?
Now,
that's science. It is.
Now, as a youngster, did you ever watch the Cosmos series?
I watched the Cosby Show a lot growing up. I really related to Theo Huxtable. He was relatable, you know? Always screwing up and looking for his dad's affection. So, definitely. I didn't watch the Cosby Show during the later years when they kept adding a new kid to keep it cute all the time, but I found that the Growing Pains episodes towards the end with Leo DiCaprio. Some riveting stuff. But the cosmos, listen, I know what you're talking about. You're talking about the show with Degrassi High.
Precisely.
I gotta tell you, I like Degrassi High, but I really like Degrassi High Special Ed. It's focusing on the romance of a lot of high school kids with learning disabilities, but it's pretty good. It's not having a Drake appearance. Anyway, I think that
a humanitarian.
I've been talking too long. I've been taking us into the cosmos, so let me return to Earth and answer that question you have for me.
The Cosmos series.
Yes, Carl Sagan's The Cosmos, I believe.
Yes, The Cosmos.
It's fantastic, riveting work. The Cosmos, well, you know what? I gotta first off just say that competition's in my blood, and that these are two very handsome gentlemen next to me. I mean, you remind me of a very young Rivers Cuomo. And man, you know that show Castle with Nathan Philippine? Philion? You kind of look like his older brother. You kind of look like, who are the two football players, the Manning brothers? You look like the older one, Eli. If you were brothers of Nathan Philippi, that's Ryan Philippi. You know what? You're just a handsome man, and you're amazing, and you have that awesome McDonald's drive-through microphone. Listen, it works for Britney Spears. It works for Garth Brooks. It works for a lot of motivational speakers, so why not? It works for this camera person, and hello. I got the mic. I feel like I've been hogging it. Guys, what I'm trying to say, though, is as handsome as these gentlemen are, competition shows involving trying to be a host of a project, that's in my blood. Like Project Runway is to a young 13-year-old Parisian. This is dear to me. So I want to, you know, I'm in it to win it. But you guys are great, and so...
Now, Jesse, could we take a walk down memory lane back to that fateful night where you became a television superstar from...
In this very city of New York.
That's right.
Honestly, it happened a mere 12 blocks from here, right in Times Square. You're talking about the very first I Want to Be a VJ competition in April of 1998. Woo! Guys, it was... Listen, any questions you ever have... I'm yours, you know? My foot size is 10 and a half, as is my dick size. But,
Thank you.
I'm just putting it out into the cosmos. But no, it's not that large at all. But what I'm getting at is this. But it looks like a solar system. What I'm trying to say is that, no, listen, you guys, I gotta say, that was such a magical time. Imagine me as a young 18-year-old, like 9 months out of high school. MTV has this competition for the first time ever. They had just opened up the Times Square studios. You know, looking out on Times Square, Carson Daly had just started, and so. Absolutely. Carson Daly of The Voice with Blake Shelton. Are there a lot of Blake heads in the audience tonight?
We've got one right here.
I think that's what they call, like, how Lady Gaga has the little monsters. I think the Blake Shelton fans are the Blake heads.
Who are your fans?
Because it's like a blockhead. What do you call Jesse Camp fans?
Yes.
Cool. I mean, really smart, cool kids that probably went to RISD at some point. But then, I have a huge, like, goth fan base, which is amazing. I go to a lot of corset signings, as one would if you have a lot of goth fans that want signed corsets.
That's how I make a lot of.
That's how I make 40% of my income is my corset line. Camp Corsets. Why not cinch it? It's a great corset, and I'm happy for the opportunity to plug it. But I don't want to get off the story that I was telling. I promise I'll give the Cliff Note version, but it's an amazing thing. So guys, long story short, I'm 18 years old, and it's kind of like a Charlie and the Chocolate Factory type scenario. MTV has decided to open up its doors to let anyone off the street between the ages of 18 and 30 come. And I don't know why they cut it off at 30, because now that I'm a little older than that at 32, you get Wikipedia my age, but I promise you, I may look 45, but I'm really only, well, I'm close to that. But let me get to the point. Basically, it's a young 18-year-old me, and so I'm this crazy kid. I'm like this weekend street kid, you know, but I'm from Connecticut. But long story short, I go into the building. Honestly, I kind of had this feeling in my heart, like, wow, maybe I could win this thing. But, you know, I went in more just for the great experience at 18 to see, like, what is the inside of the MTV studios look like. And so it's
now
just
tell,
a cool
tell
thing
me.
To do. But long story short, they picked 10 people out of that whole group of people, and then people at home voted those 10 down to 6. And then on a Saturday afternoon, I believe it's April 25th, 1998, they had a competition much like this one, except it was not to have Neil deGrasse High's Cosmos position, but to be an MTV VJ, which was back, this is also still in the days where you could go across the street to the Virgin Megastore and buy the brand new NSYNC album on cassette. So, yeah. I mean, but so long story short, yeah, it was amazing. And originally, I was only supposed to be on the air for like 2 weeks, and then that got extended to 6 weeks. And then, because what I was doing on TV was vibing with people at home, and I gotta say, it's the best feeling in the world, and I feel confident that if I keep my aging process to where it's at now and use a lot of oil of Olay Regenerist, which is also a scientific term for just nivvying up your skin. What I'm getting at is that I think that I can still parlay this into opening up a grocery store chain or two, probably in Wisconsin. At age 55, I think people will still give a fuck enough. But I don't mean to plug this stuff, you guys, but I've come full circle. I got a brand new online show myself coming out called Born to Rock and Roll, which is really cool. And we got interviews with everyone from like Miley Cyrus and the Flaming Lips to David Allan Coe to the late Scott Weiland to George Clinton to Lita Ford. I mean, all kinds of cool stuff. And so, long story short, just start Googling Jesse Camp again. Not that you do that. Who does that? No one. Trust me, I know there's A, B, C, and yo, C minus enough to still get in the door if you slip a money list. No.
I'm going to hop in here.
Yes. I'm also work shedding a one-man act, and so that's why I'm speaking so long in monologue form. But that stops now. I'm not being a show hog, and I hand it back. And thank you.
What a
letting
gracious,
me share that story.
What a gracious
it's
baton
a beautiful
pass
thing.
From the great Jesse Camp. Now,
yes.
There's something I want to point out is that of the three people on the stage right now, you are the only one with television hosting experience.
No, I also hosted Folkupplysningen.
Bless you.
I met Conan. I was on Conan.
Who have you met? You must have had so many celebrity run-ins.
I've met Conan O'Brien.
Mm-hmm.
No, I have. I've lived a blessed life, and I don't know. As you can see, I love to dress up, always have, probably. Yeah, I can't see myself in a nursing home still not rocking the fur in the wintertime, you know? What I'm getting at is that, yes, I love to crash parties. Not crash parties, why would I say crash parties? I love to get invited, and I love it when, you know, publicists just want to put me on lists. But what I'm getting at is this, is that I think I might need some kind of medication, or I might be having a seizure and or stroke on live TV. But the question was this, because I got off point. I've met all kinds of cool, like, people. Like, if you name it, I've met Bill Clinton. I've met Michael Jackson. This is honest to God truth.
Ryan
Britney
Seacrest.
Spears. Never have I met Ryan Seacrest. But throw a couple at me just for fun. And I promise.
Cher.
Cher, I did meet Cher. Yes, in fact, and I know her son, Elijah Blue, very well. And he is the son of Greg Allman and Cher. And so, Yeah, one time, like, she showed up at his house bringing him, like, groceries, just like a total mom. And it was Cher in an extravagant head wrap, scarf type thing. But she looked magnificent, and so I said hi to her for a minute. But it was more like, wow, your mom's hot, more than it was like, was that Cher? Because, you know, you kind of got to be cool about that stuff.
What about Mick Jagger?
Mick Jagger, have not met. No. Keith Richards.
So right now you're 2-for-1.
2-for-1. That sounds like a vitamin water special at 7-Eleven. This month, buy 2 vitamin waters, get the third in your pocket. You deserve to shoplift it if you already bought 2.
So I have so many questions for you right now, but I want to turn to our expert. We welcome someone that will hopefully influence the audience to make the right choice tonight. Now, he's an expert in astrophysics, an assistant director at the Clique Institute. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Michael Hickenbottom.
Yes! Pleasure to be here. What's your name again?
Davis.
It's a pleasure to be here tonight, Davis.
Yes.
Thank you with these esteemed gentlemen. It's an honor to be your judge for the third season of Cosmos that was started by my mentor, Dr. Carl Sagan. It's an absolute pleasure. So I guess I'll just go down the line with my thoughts.
Absolutely, sir.
Great.
May I just point out at the top of the questioning that I my understanding was that we were promised equal time on the show, and so that would be something that I would...
There's no Jeb Bush here, folks. It's all Donald Trump.
I don't think that's a fair comparison.
I will go back to the record. You all answered 2 questions.
Well...
That is true. I was counting. So, Dr. Tuatara, I want to say, I have read your books. While I wouldn't say as a classicist, they are up my alley. They are designed for popular consumption, which is something that it's very important on Cosmos. You carry yourself very well. You don't have hosting experience, but neither did Dr. Carl Sagan. And right now, I'd say with your background, your ability to connect intricate, complex science with the everyday man, I'd say you're my front runner.
Dr. Hickenbottom, I should just stress the importance of hosting experience.
I'll get to that.
We're not running a circus, we're teaching science.
All right, you've had your time.
On point of fact, I have not.
Mr. Simonsen, I can't say I understood your joke, but maybe it's a Norwegian thing. I don't get out there very
well,
often.
Well, I have another one.
Do you?
How far is it to the moon?
I don't know.
Well, even a giraffe can't tell you. His legs aren't tall enough that he could get up there.
Thank you, Mr. Simonsen. And Mr. Camp.
Yes.
First of all, you said you had a stroke. Are you okay?
No, that's a question I ask myself on a daily basis.
I see.
That's scientific, though. I
don't mean to be a buzzkill. You're obviously very charismatic. It's very interesting fashion choice. But I have to ask, have you ever taken a science class?
You don't have to answer that.
No. I'm willing to go on the record here.
That's a dismissive
question. I've taken
a
lot of chemistry courses.
Are those amateur?
I know a little about kinetic energy.
Where did you study, sir?
Funny you should ask that. Basically, I do want to point out that I did a wonderful thesis, and actually I have an honorary doctorate in jazz studies from Cornell.
Honorary doctorate? Okay. Sir, do any of these terms mean anything to you? The redshift?
Absolutely, the redshift. I hate to go on a pedestal here and divide our world, but fracking is a very real thing.
Okay. You don't
and
know.
How about pollution in China is crazy. It's just crazy what they're doing there. as far as putting pollutants out into the world with all of their factories. What I'm getting at this, sure, it might be an issue for the UN, but the red shift is the thought process of adopting the red communism kind of theory on pollution from China.
That's correct.
I remember a time when you would go to North Dakota and it was peaceful. In fact, you would pump your gas first and pay in North Dakota up until 2010. Now there's crazy fracking there, and all I know is the last time I was in Bismarck, it was $12 for a gallon of milk, and it was only a half gallon. So what I'm getting at is this. I ain't a fan of the red shift. Climate change is real. Bernie Sanders, you got my vote. If not, Bernie.
Dr. Hickenbottom, I just I want to mention this right here. You've got a little egg on your face. That's what you get for underestimating a fellow host. I have a very distinct honor right now. I'm going to introduce you to our musical guest. You could see them March 26th at Baby's All Right in Brooklyn. Sleep Talk / Dinner 8, their 7-inch is out now on Father Daughter Records, and they have a new album coming later this year. Please give it up for Diet Cig. Exciting performance from Diet Cig. Let's give them one more hand.
Yes.
If you're just joining us, we have three candidates here that are vying to be the new host of Cosmos 3, Adventures Through the Multiverse. Now, we're going to the quantum level with our next segment. We've asked our three contestants to demonstrate a complex scientific concept in the simplest way possible. Now, let's begin with Dr. Tuatara. Your challenge is to explain the nanostructure of an atom to our studio audience. You have 90 seconds.
The classical model of the atom is that there is a nucleus about which an electron orbits like a little miniature solar system. But the quantum model exploded this old view. Imagine all the electrons of an atom are Easter eggs, and quantum mechanics is the bunny hiding them. Now, If you could each take one of these little colorful electrons. Now each of the electrons has its own orbit, which is discrete. Max Planck discovered that there were certain quanta that the eggs or electrons must inhabit, much like rows of a theater audience. You can imagine each of these, or these eggs could be little guests at a party, but of course they're all completely identical. Imagine being at a party with 100 Aunt Sallys. Now let's mix our eggs up. Let's move them around.
And mix this... those eggs up, but not if you're ovulating. Then you're getting preggers.
So each have our own time to do our segments. So imagine.
Decorum, please.
What?
Decorum. No, play with your eggs, please.
Imagine that each.
Hey now, guys, come on.
Thank you. Imagine that each. Imagine that each. Imagine so the class. In the classical model.
Boo.
Man, I haven't.
You
I haven't heard anyone say fuck eggs since the great scramble off of 88. I mean, I'm not trying to be a flutin' patootin', but come on. I know you can do better than that, man. Because you're a good guy. And right now, you are giving a substitute teacher performance. You got to go out there and do it for real, from the heart.
Decorum.
We've seen the physical realm of the very small. Now, Daniel, we'll turn our focus to the very large. The universe is 13.82 billion years old. There are billions of galaxies, and each galaxy has billions of suns, just like our sun. And the unimaginable greatness of the known universe, we could be merely a speck of dust suspended in the cosmic dark. Now, how do you, a scientist, relate to the sheer vastness of the cosmos to the average person? You have 90 seconds.
Hello. For me, right?
60 seconds.
The universe is everything, and everything is equally important. For example, a rock on the ground is not any more important than I am. That also has its job here on the planet. Okay, can I be honest? Is it okay? can I be honest? I met this girl called Janine when I was studying physics at the Calvi Institute in Santa Barbara. I just want to be with her. If I get this job, I can get a green card and I can stay in the US. And isn't that what the American dream is about? Yeah, giving the chance to the foreigner who comes here with his dream. Because you people, in you, I see the American dream in your eyes. I see your-
In 90 seconds.
Thank you.
All right, come on, that was kick-ass, definitely.
Let's make science exciting again. Jesse?
All right. Yeah. And I am here to talk to you about science, but-
Jesse, allow me to help you out here.
Sure.
Why do we study science? Why do we gaze up at the stars? To know ourselves, maybe to dream of our place in the great darkness? The crux of human discovery lies in man's capacity to wonder. And we look up at the sky and think, what's up there? What's up there for me? Where's the weirdest place you've had sex?
I thought when you said what's up there for me is how do you keep it up? And I do that with Viagra, folks. And that's an amazing display of science, but I think the most amazing display of science is when we look in the mirror, when we look out at a beautiful room like this, and there are other beings just like us, and we're all together experiencing a beautiful thing as one unit. And we're all individuals, but we're part of something greater. I'm not trying to lure you to a Christian cult. But what I'm trying to say is that I think the most amazing science is within us and within all of us. What I'm getting at is E equals MC Hammer. Right? Am I right? I think that about sums it up. But no, listen. And I know that I am teetering on the brink of my 90 seconds, but what I'd like to say is this. I take hosting very seriously. If you wanted me to host a show on creme brulee, which is a food on the Food Channel, or a food that you can order in French restaurants. By the way, I had an idea for a French bistro with a lot of young employees called Statutory Crepe. But, yo, I did not go on Shark Tank with that idea, folks. I was just testing it, and it's no go. It's gross. But, keep it on Craigslist. But what we're getting at is you give me a show topic, I'm going to host the hell out of that show. Like, put me on Court TV, and, yo, Nancy Grace is angry that the defense just got their argument and motion denied. Well, I am too, and I'll be up on that. Or if you put me on the Tennis Network, believe you me, when those Williams sisters are on the court, I will be telling you all about that. Oh, thank you.
Jesse, I don't think you need to make your case. This audience obviously loves you.
I'll put it to you this way. If you put me on the Dildo Channel, although I already have extensive knowledge of strap-ons, I will strap on my think hat, know everything there is, and then I will host America's largest dildo like the host that you know I can be! You know what I'm saying?
All right, I'm going to throw it to Dr. Hickenbottom. How can you argue with that?
I really can't argue with that, because to form an argument, you have to have rational
passion.
Thought.
Hey, Morgan Freeman hosts a very similar show.
Mr. Camp, I will say this. The audience does seem to love you. I mean, it's...
Thank you.
But
and
I want to
say...
But
everyone look under your seats, because that's right. Free camp corsets for every studio audience.
Mr. Camp, Mr. Camp, while you are obviously charismatic, I just don't know if you're a science host, but I want to move to your two other finalists. Mr. Simonsen, you said you were a scientist, and what is that? What exactly is your field?
Space.
Because it didn't seem like you understood the concept of the vastness of the universe, and I have to mark you down for that. But moving on to Dr. Turitara's, I feel you were frazzled. You seemed out of your element. Your metaphor was completely lost on me.
Yeah,
Jesse was right. You could have done a lot better. You lost the audience. I'm not really. I feel like we're fighting for last place here, gentlemen.
Except for the Easter eggs.
I don't know what he said.
He was heckling him about his silly Easter eggs.
The Easter eggs were very silly. Nobody.
If there is another chance, or if we can get another chance, you know.
There goes the nucleus.
Look, Mr. Dr. Tuatara, I think you need to cool off. I'm going to throw it back to our musical guest tonight.
Are you Japanese? Tarata? What?
Tuatara.
Okay.
It's New Zealand.
Ladies and gentlemen, once again, here's Diet Cig.
Trust in God. she's not as loud. Does it feel better to be?
Again, we're looking to find the new host of Cosmos 3 into the Q continuum. In this section, I'm going to ask the contestants to use their own particular set of skills to put a unique twist on something that they've studied throughout their career. Now, I'm going to begin with Gene. Gene?
Hey there. Hey, what was your name again?
Derek. To some, astrophysics is one of the more complex studies in academia, but with an understanding of it, you could be on the forefront of discovering some of the grandest mysteries in the universe. Now, how would you explain that to the average person?
Well, you know, what I would explain is I would say, what I love about the universe is looking at heavenly bodies. And I love a pair of great orbs, you know? And I too, am one of the pornographers of youth culture. And I enjoy sexual entertainment.
Why do you have those?
I keep all my mail is in the back of my car. But what I love right now.
Is that a cigarette?
Yes.
Put that cigarette.
I wasn't gonna light them. They're bad for you. But you should welcome out one of the cute bunnies that lives in my hutch. Come out here, baby.
Oh. You don't.
Hello, I'm Dr. Janet Tuatara.
Yeah.
I've been married for 23 years, and I love him, and I want him to get the show, so sometimes you do what you gotta do.
And we're willing to do just about anything. Mm-hmm. But so, you know, she's smart, she's a doctor too. And
this is your wife?
This is my wife.
Yeah,
you know?
I actually was just on the team that helped discover the gravity waves.
Later on, we're gonna make some waves in our waterbed.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, should get your pants off, baby.
I'm sorry. What are you two trying to accomplish here?
What do you mean? I can be cool, and I don't have a hat, but maybe I'm interesting too. And I, if charisma is what we're most interested in, then
fine.
That's a new kind of competition, isn't
it? I fell in love with Gene when he was younger, and
we're open to anything. If you want to join us, out there,
we've been exclusive
well,
for 23 years.
Well, maybe we should have a third baby. You know, couldn't that be a
little
bit of fun?
You know what? I don't. You didn't ask me about that before. I'm not going to take my pants off. You know I've got a weird scar running down my leg. And I'm not going to show it to anyone, Gene.
That's like Terry Richardson stuff. Come on, baby. Show it to him, baby.
I'm not going to show anyone, Gene! Stop it! I'm not showing anyone! Fuck you, Gene. Brian Cox has been calling me every single night. I'm moving to Oxford. I'm gonna fuck him every night.
No.
You wanted a divorce? I read it in your journal. You're getting a divorce, Gene. You're getting a divorce!
I can't have that.
I'm up for a Nobel Prize this year! Good luck on your fucking TV show.
Oh, let's not be presumptuous here. Oh, boy. Gene, I'm sorry I made fun of your Victoria's Secret magazines. I'm sure you'll get plenty of use out of them. But I'm going to have to ask you to clear the floor.
Some of the other ones said bad things, too.
Because you've taken up so much of our time with this... whatever that was, we're just going to bring out Daniel Simonsen once again, and we're going to ask him the same question. You could come on. I didn't know. The stage is yours, sir.
Can I borrow this?
Absolutely. Yeah.
I'm just going to spit some bars.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah, my hat, please. Oh, thank you. And my dancers. You guys, you just do your thing back here, and then I take charge of the front. Science is cool, science is fresh. Science makes you want to go to school. Science is fun. Science is edgy. Science makes you want to get drunk in the bar with some hot bitches talking about the moon. The moon is a club we're going to later. And do you know who will be in the club? 50 Cent is in the club. 50 Cent is in the club with Jay-Z and Action Bronson and Nas. Smoking some weed, sipping on that champagne, talking about scientific issues that are important today. Because science is cool, science is you, science is me, science is she. Science is Beyoncé. Science is the stars on the American flag. Come on, everybody, clap your hands. That's right. Stay real, be yourself, educate, and have sex. Okay, that's enough, it's enough. That was great.
Okay. I can't read my prompter. And he needs no introduction, Jesse Camp.
I have not come by myself. I've brought along New York City's legendary and favorite son, the best bass player. Well, Didi is great, but there is no denying how amazing this man is, Mr. Mike Denine. Hey. All right. You know, I gotta say, out of all Mike's talents, probably his biggest one is just being a great best friend, you know?
The rest of felonies.
Yeah, that's true. Mike can make a balloon disappear faster than a magician on a budget. What I'm getting here, though, is we've shared a lot over the years, and what we'd like to share tonight. Yes, it's true. We downloaded a lot of music illegally in the early 2000s. Okay, sorry, prosecutor. I will admit to those charges, but not the grand larceny or possession. What I'm getting at is that Mike is a sick, amazing bass player, and you can hear all of his talents on the brand new Deceivers album coming out later this year, but...
Mostly, we're just good at living the dream.
That's right.
It's what we do. We can come out here, do whatever we can. We can have a hoedown.
Well, yeah. We're hoedown. That's what I call a hoedown and a growdown.
It's just how we roll. We could thumb wrestle.
We could do a lot with our thumbs in the wrestling department. But if it's okay with you guys, we'd like to pick each other's noses. Woo! But before we do that, Mike and I would also like to share a dream of ours with you guys. And long story short, we took a summer abroad in Paris recently.
Started on a stormy night.
It certainly did. We were flying standby on a Virgin Airlines flight to Zenith Airport, which is actually nowhere near Paris. But what I'm getting at is this.
3 o'clock.
We were very inspired by mime. And we decided to use all of our years of felonies and tribulations with the court system to our benefit and start a mime group called Operation Mime Crime.
Tribute to Queensryche.
Tribute to Queensryche, the Jeff Tate version. And no, Queensryche fans. If you're a Queensryche fan, you're gonna love this. Can we do our Operation Mind? I'm sorry, Operation Mime Crime routine, just to finish out our talent portion.
I mean, I would have to take the time away from the other two contestants, but I'll allow it.
Fuck them.
Here's your gear. You take your coat hanger. I'll take my coat hanger. All right. Oh, zut alors, Michael. It is a car. Do you think we can break in?
Yeah.
I have the coat hanger. All right, that works for me. Let's loot this shit. Boom! Woo! Operation Mind! But you guys, honestly, from the bottom of my heart, and I have no idea what camera to look in, but Mike is an amazing brother. He played with Gigi Allen and the Murder Junkies, of course. Woo! The 8th Street Kids with me, and he's a brother, and his band, The Deceivers. They're amazing if you're in the New York area, or check your local website, thedeceivers.com. See if they're coming to your area. They just might, and you gotta see them live.
And I'm sure somewhere right now, both Gigi and Carl Sagan are watching on with bated breath. Ladies and gentlemen, you voted. It's only time that, we count the tallies and see who is going to be the next superstar of science. So, can I have a drum roll, please? Something like Megan. Okay. Let's see who the winner is. Oh, by a whopping 97%, the next superstar of science and host of Cosmos 3, Age of Ultron, here is Jesse Camp!
What? What?
Congratulations, what? Sir.
Thank you so much. Oh.
Jesse!
You guys, come on!
So... Can we have the contract, please?
Oh, yes.
So I'm just going to need you to come over here and sign this.
Sure thing.
I'm so sorry. I'm sure you'll have successful careers.
I lost elsewhere. Something important to me. I lost something really important to me.
Yes, I know. Fine. and, sir, what a nice song.
Thanks.
Is there anything else I could do in the production?
That's Jesse's call.
I think we have a new party coordinator! Boom! Because that's how you get it done. I mean, you're in the club with 50 and Nas, Drinking out of a schnoz and hitting the Ciroc with P. Diddy, that is living the American dream to me. Yeah. Or at least being a douchey stockbroker. Either or, I'll see everyone tonight at my celebration at One Oak. Sponsored by Ciroc. No, that's not real, but I am taking everyone out tonight to Sbarro's Pizza.
Thank you so much for watching, and one more time for Jesse Camp.
Thank you so much for letting me be the host of this. And I do want to let producers and everyone in the television industry know that, of course, I am going to have to make a serious time commitment to being the new host of Cosmos with Tyson Degrassi. But I still have time on my hands if you feel I can host anything. Really, seriously, I'm hungry to work, and I have three ex-wives, so I kind of need it. So,
Should I give this guy some advice?
I've been in the doghouse before, and the only way out is to take that bathrobe and put it in the trash and just go to Joss A. Banks. I know it's kind of expensive, but you know how at Men's Warehouse they say you're going to like the way you look? If you go to Joss A. Banks, you're going to like how you look for about an hour, then you're going to realize that this 45-year-old divorcee was telling you you look good in that tail stripe, only to get you to spend an outrageous fortune. Note to everyone out there, Joss A. Banks does not have a good return policy, especially if they feel you stained their clothing. They're real bitches. But anywho, I'm honored to be the host of this. I'm going to sign this 100% real contract right now. And guys, I'd like to also give a shout out to everyone here behind the scenes, because this is an amazing group of people, and especially this man, who I know is the host of this show, but I've seen him in other guises, and I'm a humongous fan of yours. And I think it's amazing you do a brand new show every week, and I am honored that the planets aligned and you guys had me on. And I'd just like to say, I am happy to make an appearance anytime I'm in the New York or Greater New Jersey area.
Thank you, and let's not lift the veil too much, but thank you so much for being on the show.
Yes.
A big hand for all the contestants, and have the contracts been signed?
Oh, it has not.
Then let's check this out. Not. Get a nice close up on that.
I'm using my real legal name, which is Seymour Hoffman.
And with that,
is
signed the new host of Cosmos 3, Jesse Camp.
Yay! Thank you very much.
And we hit the mark.
That's our show!
Yeah. Oh my God. All right. Hey, it's a wig. Hey.
Hold on.
Thanks everybody for coming. Darren, hold on. Thanks everybody for coming. I want to give a hand to Daniel Simonsen.
Andrew Tisher.
Jesse Camp. What was your friend's name again, Mike?
Mike Denied, you want to come on?
Mike Denied, come on up.
Come on!
Yay!
Hell yeah, Mike Denied!
Thank you so much, man. As always, Mr. Joke, Steve Whalen, Darren, maybe Diet Cig! Come on up!
Diet Cig, get over here. Hold on. Just hold on.
Yeah.
I'm just going to read this. Mm-hmm. This notarized document states that the competitor on the MNN television program, The Special Without Brett Davis, on 17th of February in the year 2016, with the most fan votes, will hereby be granted full hosting duties and ownership of said television program.
Big ups to Joe Nelfo, who made
this. Will you just hold on? This document is fully binding, cannot be contested in any court of law. It's notarized. You're an idiot. Oh. No offense.
I'm an idiot?
It's official. He signed here. Jesse Camp is the new host of the special. Official.
Yeah. Okay.
He says, okay.
I'm not Jay Leno. I can't take another man's show.
It says right here, this 100% real contract, Jesse is the new host. I don't know who made this. You don't have a lawyer, do you?
Yeah, I don't have a lawyer.
Alan Dershowitz and co-counsel Mike Denine.
Of course he has a fucking lawyer. I don't have a lawyer.
Well, I know you don't have a lawyer.
Listen, we just want a cut of the name of the show again that I own now is
The Special Without Brett Davis.
Yeah, the special. with or without Brett Davis. Yeah. I can't live without Brett Davis. Brett, there would be no The Special without you. You're what makes The Special so special, along with this amazingly talented group of writers and stylists and everyone that comes together and the amazing studio audience. But come on, you are The Special.
But
no, basically Jesse, I just want some merchandising rights. And if The Special gets turned into a movie starring Will Arnett, I want half the profits. That's all this contract means.
Legally, Jesse, you're entitled to all the profits.
Oh, great. Okay. All right. Listen.
Brett officially owes you like.
Shut up. Is this because of L.A.?
Fuck you with L.A.
Oh, fuck you.
Maybe.
I love L.A. We love it.
We can't pay for that song.
Okay.
All right, well,
Randy Newman is a fan.
With Jesse Camp next week. Yeah.
Guys, how about we do this? Because I do have a lot of commitments to my other polygamous Mormon families. I did stutter there, but I'll be out with it. I have sister wives. Anywho, they do take up a lot of my time. I could host maybe once every 8 weeks, but I gotta say that the permanent guest host is back to the man that started the whole thing. Ladies and gentlemen, the Craig Ferguson of The Special, I'm talking about, you know, because I'd be Letterman in this crazy dream scenario. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the man for Down Under, Brett Davis! Your host.
Yay. Camera one
on the BD.
It's all of us. Sorry. What the fuck is this?